Welcome back, everyone. This is Darmari Komo, and I'll be your host for the rest of the day. Joining me is Kevin from engineering team. Hey, Kevin, welcome back here. And tell us who you are and then what are you going to talk about this session.
Thank you. So I'm my name is Kevin Liu. I'm a principal lead PM, program manager in the SQL Server Engine team. And this session is focusing on the DBA experience for in-memory OLTP.
So to get everyone on the same page, can you just do a quick recap on in-memory OLTP so that we all in the same level?
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So in-memory OLTP, actually, I just did an overview about an hour ago, and there are four main pillars for the principles of design for in-memory OLTP. And I'm not going to elaborate on those, and you can watch the previous video. But I want to highlight just what they are and which part of the engine they reside in. So the memory optimization for tables and index structures, and latch-free, lock-free concurrency control, those are primarily in the storage engine. And as far as the native compilation and of store procedures, that's in the relational engine. And the last one, of course, is very important, which is the in-memory OLTP is fully integrated into SQL Server. And so for this session, which is the DBA focused, we'll be mostly focusing on the storage engine side. And I will, most likely you have seen this already, but I want to quickly run through this. It ties some of the key concepts together. Mm-hmm. And if you don't fully grasp all the detail, that's okay. During this session, we'll stitch some of the key concepts, such as memory and storage, together with more details. So this is what you see for SQL Server today. Essentially, if you look from top down through the stack, you have the TDS layer, then you have the QO, query optimizer, query processor layers. Then you get into the storage engine, which is access methods. Then in the buffer pool, we have four tables as an example. And then in the storage, you have the log and you have the data file group, right? And how Hackathon fit into this picture is that we actually use the same memory space, but we don't use buffer pool. And we also have a separate checkpoint file group. And the reason we have a separate checkpoint group is because the I/O pattern is very different. We use only sequential I/O. That's why we can reuse the on-disk-based tables data files. And for tables to be migrated to in-memory database, they actually don't exist in the buffer pool anymore. And just to remind you quickly, the table is fully logged and checkpointed, but index only exists in memory. And to access those tables, we can simply use query interop mode, which is essentially operating on those tables as if they're just regular SQL tables. And but that's not the fastest way to use the system. There is a fast path, what we call a natively compiled store procedures. And this is where the business logic is further compiled into DLL, and you run at the native machine speed. And lastly, I want to highlight that the table can be also defined as non-durable. By default, it's durable, means it's all the committed records will be there upon recovery. But you can also define a table to be non-durable. Then all the I/O overhead is gone from that situation. Then you essentially use the table as a relational cache, right? That's a very interesting scenario for a lot of people. Anyways, that's the recap. For this session, I'm going to focus on memory and later on in storage.
Okay, yeah. Tell us how does in-memory OLTP uses memory? How does it manage it? How does it control and so on and so forth? Can you describe in more detail?
Yep. So let's first look at the data structure. So one misconception people had is in-memory database simply forcing the data pages to sit in memory? The answer is absolutely not. We already have that in a legacy concept called DBCC pin table, which actually has been deprecated since 2005. So that's not it. The data structure is fully optimized for in-memory. That means we essentially design a high-speed relational cache, and then make sure below it you have the full ACID properties of a database, and above it you expose the full T-SQL surface area, right? So that's really the essence of in-memory OLTP. But then you look at the data records, for example, roles. The roles are no longer stored in data pages, right? I mentioned this briefly before. The only reason people put data pages there, 8K pages, is not for high-speed data access. It's merely for a transfer, I/O transfer, block transfer to and from the disk I/O, right? So that's really not the design principle here. If you optimize for in-memory access, you don't use those constructs anymore. So I will show you later on what the role format is. As far as indexes, we only have non-clustered index because the data access really is only one pointer away. You don't need to cluster the indexes for disk sequential access, right? So that's the reason you have clustered index for SQL, but you don't need those concepts anymore. Indexes just simply is a pointer to the rows, and we have two types of indexes, which may have been covered in the previous session. One is hash index for point lookup. The other one is what we call range index, but the syntax is just non-clustered index, and those are for ordered scans, right? And as I mentioned before, all the index don't exist on disk. They don't exist in log, they don't exist in checkpointing, and they only exist in memory. Okay. And another key concept here, moving back slightly here, roles are versioned. So this is another important concept I want to highlight, is that we never update a role in place. They're all versioned. That's how we ensure non-blocking operations. So this is a quick, you know, schematic of the role structure. As you can tell, there is a fixed overhead for the header for the role. And you know, you have a timestamp, beginning and end. So the begin and end timestamp is an indication of what valid period or what valid period it's visible for a transaction, right? The transaction always have a start timestamp. If it falls between begin and end in this case, then that transaction can see this role, otherwise it cannot. And then you have some other overhead. And the largest one I want to point out is the index links. We allow up to 8 indexes, and the indexes are a way we chain the rows together, and so you must have at least one single index. And also, I want to point out that the row size, the limit is 80/60. It's not something inherently we have to enforce in memory OLTP, but we want to enforce the same 8K limit so that you can transfer the data back and forth between disk-based tables and in-memory OLTP. And at table creation time, you need to make sure all the sums of the column width is less than that. So in other words, if you have a 5,000, you know, varchar and another 5,000 varchar, it will actually fail in the creation. And but you know, as you know, in SQL you actually allow that, right? But actually, let's say you define 2,000-4,000 varchars, the actual allocation at runtime will only use whatever you allocate. We don't actually automatically use 4K, but we do want to, for compilation reasons, enforce that limit upfront. So that's one thing to watch out for. So not all the SQL table schema is supported. The compatibility level is relatively high. But there are certain things that's not supported. For example, lob is not supported. SQL variant is not supported. Lob, we actually do plan to support for the next version. SQL variant, it's possible we'll never support it. The reason is a typeless operation is rarely used in high-performance OLTP workloads.
Okay.
So this is a quick way to see how those roles are chained together through indexes. And as you can tell, we have two hash indexes, one on name, one on city, and the roles are chained together through the index structure, as I mentioned before. So the index is almost like the connective tissue tying the roles together. That's how we navigate across the roles. Okay. The other type of index, as I mentioned before, is a range index. So going back to the hash index is a very quick way to do a point lookup on the columns you define the index on, right? However, if you want to do a range scan or order scan, let's say, you know, for example, the value is between this and that, the hash index doesn't actually work. You will actually do a full table scan. In that case, you want to define a range index, which is actually using a trace structure for the index itself. And then it just points to the row. So this is where the ordering happened in the index structure. And then we can do order scan very efficiently. So one important thing to call out here is the tree we used here is also versioned. That is, we don't have a direct update on the interim index pages. That's how we get around high contention issues, how we scale up. So a couple things to call out about memory management is that we actually treat memory as the storage, right, essentially, as memory, a compute storage. And in other words, you cannot overflow your memory. There is no paging out, you know, once you exceed your memory limit. And if you do exceed your memory limit, you actually will run into auto memory errors. The transaction would fail. And when the, you know, for example, a row goes out of the view, gets deleted, you know, with a different timestamp, what we maintain is the oldest timestamp for the system for transactions. That means the last visibility. If a row's end time falls beyond that range, that means it can be safely removed from the system. Then we have a process called garbage collection kicking in, and we remove those memory spaces and reclaim them, right? 2014, we optimized for 256 gig of in-memory table used for user data. We haven't tested beyond that point, so this is the guidance for users not to exceed this amount. So as far as resource governor, it's fully integrated for in-memory database. And the reason we want to have resource governor play a key role here is that in-memory database will use memory and can potentially put pressure on the SQL buffer pool side. And you don't want that boundary to be undefined. So it's possible that in-memory database will put so much pressure on the SQL side, the SQL performance becomes unpredictable, right? So the resource governor is here to safeguard the system stability in case that the in-memory OLTP side takes too much memory. So I will actually show you a demo on how this works and also show you how to do the quick calculation for memory usage and how to monitor that later. So quick recap, for the user data, because ever since the version, we don't update in place, rule of thumb is about roughly 2x of your usable data size for the memory allocation. The reason is we don't simply just update, right? We always delete and insert. So update operation will translate into two rows, and the older one, the older row would be terminated, but it will take time to get reclaimed. So that row version overhead has to be accounted for. As far as the indexes, the index primary overhead for hash index is the pointers, and it's a bucket count that you define in the hash index multiplied by 8 bytes. So that's essentially the overhead for hash index. And when you define hash index, the rule of thumb is roughly 2x of the number of rows as the bucket count, and then you multiply by 8 bytes, you know the overhead for the hash index. And for range index is a variable size. It's really just the set of keys plus the final pointer to the row. So those are the ways you can do a very quick calculation to understand index overhead for memory usage. As far as management, we have a lot of tools, DMVs, is also SSMS reports. I will show you how to monitor the usage. And as far as control, the primary tool is resource governor. You can set the cap for in-memory OLTP to make sure you don't jeopardize or destabilize the SQL side workload.
You mentioned a little bit about garbage collection earlier, and it's very important to basically eliminate some of the unused rows in the memory. Could you actually talk about it more detail?
Yep. So as I mentioned, that everything is versioned, and if a version has n timestamp of infinity, that means it's current version, right? If the n timestamp is no longer infinity, but set with a specific timestamp, it means it's an obsolete role. But if there is a transaction start time, which is actually before that n timestamp, you cannot reclaim that role. But once the oldest transaction in the system moves beyond that point, we do maintain a system-level oldest transaction timestamp, right? So if that timestamp moves beyond this role's n timestamp, then the role is up for a recollection, recollecting. And once it's recollected, the memory is freed and just recycled back for other allocation. So the important thing about garbage collection design here is it's non-blocking, it's cooperative, and that's actually the important keyword in that even though there is a dedicated garbage collection thread to make sure there is no dusty corners, etc., all the active transaction work will come in and actively pick up whatever you're scanning to do garbage collection along the way. So this is the way we can scale, right? Imagine a single thread of garbage collection, there is no way it can scale to keep up with, let's say, you know, 30, 40, 50 user sessions, right? Because each user session comes in and does its own part of contribution of garbage collection, that's how the system of garbage collection can actually keep up with very heavy user workloads and heavy version reclaiming garbage collection. So this is a quick example for this. So let's say the transaction itself, the beginning timestamp is 210. That means anything falls between, you know, it falls, you know, from before 210 to until after 210 is visible for this transaction, cannot be reclaimed. But the system-wide oldest active hint, transaction timestamp hint, is 175. So when this transaction is scanning through a set of rows through the index, you can see that there are two infinity ones. That just remind you that the first two headers, elements are beginning and end timestamp. They're current, right? There are two infinity that's current. And then the third row is actually terminated around timestamp 100. That means it can be reclaimed. So this active user thread that scans through the rows would actually delink this and relink the rows together and actually reclaim that memory space. So that's how it works from the user thread. Okay. So I think just want to remind people, the most important part of the GC is it's designed in such a way that even though we only have one single thread for garbage collection, the system is able to keep up with very active churns of the data operation.
Great. So the other side of things is the how do we control the memory? Because you have in-memory OLTP and then the disk-based SQL server that share the same EXE. How do you actually control the memory between the two?
Yep. Great question. So this is to set a limit on the in-memory OLTP max memory allocation to prevent instability of the regular SQL workloads or pressure on the buffer pool, right? And so the way to use this is pretty straightforward. You define a dedicated pool for in-memory OLTP, and you bind a database which has in-memory OLTP elements to the resource pool, and then it's going to be limited. And the limit is actually not the whole 100% of the resource pool you define. Depending on your internal pool size, which is essentially your system allocation for SQL, we actually will gauge conservatively to reserve certain spaces. Because if you have a system operation, we have to ensure that system operations such as GC, etc., or rollbacks can actually happen, right? So we don't want the system to get to the top and then the system can get stuck. So the rule of thumb is around 70-80% the system will actually give you out of error messages when you run to that kind of limit until for the resource pool. And we actually have a demo to show you that too.
Okay, sure. Let's see the demo.
All right, so, okay, let me try again. So in, I just want to talk about the demo a little bit. It's a little bit complex, so it's a lot of elements. Don't worry about the syntax, right? If you follow the syntax, you won't be able to follow the demo. So what I'm trying to show you is a quick way to compute the index overhead and figure out the memory allocation yourself in the hard way. Now I'm going to show you the simple way to do it, right? Okay. But hard way will teach you how to actually understand the internals and of memory allocation. And also, I will show you how to use resource governor to set the memory limit, and what if you run out of that limit, what do you do?
Okay.
Okay. So in this case, let's drop the existing database and start from scratch. I'll just create a stub database in this case. And I need to create a checkpoint container for in-memory database to use the in-memory objects. And I just need to give a physical file folder for the file group in this case. You can actually inline everything into one single statement, but I'm just breaking everything into little parts here. And use this database. Okay. So the table, let me move down a little bit so you can see all the definition of the table. Okay. So the table has integer, money, small int real, I think it's 4 bytes, 8 bytes, 2 bytes, and I believe 8 bytes. And you can see the inline index definition. We have a hash index of 1 million buckets, and another hash index, and a third hash index of 1 million. And the last one is a range index, right? You see the syntax is just non-clustered. And this whole thing is memory optimized on. We make sure there is full durability. So that's the definition of the table.
Okay.
So let's create the table. Okay. So now, even without any data in the system, we already have indexes defined, right? So there is already memory overhead for the index. So if you remember, going back to what we talked before, we have 3 hash index defined, and each hash index is 1 million buckets, and each pointer is 8 bytes, right? So if you calculate in KB, essentially get 24 megabytes of hash index overhead, right? And you can actually look at through the DMV, which is a DM, DB, XTP, table, memory stats. It's a mouthful, but this is a very useful DMV, and you can actually see the table, the data itself doesn't take any memory yet, but indexes take this much. You may notice that the range index actually don't have any value here, right? Actually, that's correct, because the range index has this internal tree, which if you don't have a data, it doesn't have a tree. Right, so there is no fixed overhead from range index. Let's now insert 1 million rows, and let's recheck the size. Let's say we insert 1 million row. What do we expect? We know the row size already, and in the beginning, actually, I showed you the header structure. The header of each row has a 22-byte overhead, and we know there are 4 pointers. This is a pointer overhead, so those are overheads. So it's 22 plus 4 multiplied by 8, that's overhead. And then you have payloads in front of it. So as DBAs, we only do calculations through select clause. So you got 76, right? So we know each row is roughly 76 bytes. And range index is essentially the key plus a pointer. And the key, where it's on a single 4-byte value, so the key is 4, so we get 12 megabytes, essentially, for 1 million rows. So let's see if our theory is correct, okay? So in this case, I'm just looping through. By the way, I'm using interop mode. You see, I'm inserting into this table as if it's just a regular SQL table, right? there is no native compiled store proc. So this is what we call interop mode. And after we do the insertion, let's check the memory usage again. Remember, we said you know, it's 76. It's correct, right? You multiply it by 1024. And the indexes went up. So essentially, it's what we showed you before, plus the additional 12 megabytes of range index. So it's pretty precise. So exactly what happened is what I just talked through. Those are overheads. In the meantime, I want to show you the simple way to do this. This is the hard way, right? Nobody wants to figure out your memory usage this way. This is just simply to tell you what happens under the hood. But if you right-click on the database we created and look at reports, and you can look at memory usage by memory optimized objects, you get a very nice report telling you all the allocation, you know, for different objects. So this is a much easier way. Underneath, uses the same DMV, but gives you a very nice graphical view. Okay. So we did this the hard way and the easy way, and now let's look at a resource governor. So in this case, don't worry about the trace flag. It will be removed for RTM. And I'm going to set a max and min, basically set the server memory at 4 gigabyte, just make it simple. This is my laptop. I have 8 gigabyte of physical memory. And you can see what the configuration is. Right, 4 gigabyte for min and max. And then we create the resource pool, which is called pool HK DB1. And we set this to be 40% of the max we already defined. Okay, so essentially it's 1.6 gig. And now you can use another DMV to see the configuration here. The DMV is DM resource governor resource pools. And now we actually need to bind the database to the pool. And in this case, you can use this query to check. Actually, we'll publish all the queries on the blog and make sure you have a copy of it. So don't worry about jogging them down. I think you can't type that fast. So here, this is a quick way to check. Is the database bound to a pool? It's not yet. So let's bind the database to the pool. And you do need to take the database offline and take it back online. The reason is the memory is already allocated. Mm-hmm. If you don't take it offline online, you can't really ensure it will stay with the resource pool. And very simple operation here. Now go back and check the binding. You can see that on the bottom, the database is bound to the pool. Okay. So now let's use it. Let's define a table. I will try to put in as many records as possible and fill it up and see what happens. So in this case, I define a table, pretty simple, just a lot of characters, and with just one index, hash index. And here, you can see I'm doing interop again. So I'm just trying to insert 200,000 rows. And now, interesting thing is this. Okay, so let me resize this properly. Sorry, let me didn't size this properly. Okay, it's a little bit better now. Okay, so the green line is the target, and the highlighted line is what's been used. So you can see the memory is going up and up. Suddenly it stopped there. And if you go back to the query, if you look at the query here, we're inserting each row as a separate transaction. So essentially, we don't roll back the whole thing, right? So the last insert would fail. And you did get an insufficient amount of memory error in the end. So it will stop. But you can, as you can tell here, that the memory is actually filled up to the brim, right? And but it's not 100%, as I mentioned. You know, there is a roughly 85% or 80% will actually save some overhead for the system operation, and it will give you auto memory error. So what do you do now? The question is, you're stuck, right? In this case, you can't insert more rows. What do you do? So the way to get around it is actually quite straightforward. You can simply, one way to do it is just simply bump up the resource pool to a higher threshold. In this case, I'm bumping up to 80%. And you can see from my resource monitor, the green line jumped, right? Mm-hmm. So now the ceiling actually moved up. Okay, and now we can actually insert additional rows. And in this case, you can see that we can keep on adding more rows, right? So this is how you play with that memory ceiling and how do you recover if you exceed it. At least one way to do it.
Awesome. Right, Kevin, so you've shown how to calculate the memory usage in in-memory OLTP and then show us how to use the resource governor as well. There's the other side of things, which is the disk portion, because we still need to make sure all the transaction is durable and everything. Can you talk about the storage portion of things? Do we have to worry about that?
That's correct. So if you define the table as non-durable, mm-hmm. then you don't have to worry about it, right? So then it's a true relational cache scenario. Mm-hmm. In that case, you don't have to worry about I/O at all, right? There is no logging, no checkpointing. However, if you want your data to be durable, then the memory we're talking about here is not NVRAM, right? It's right. not non-volatile RAM. They're still DRAM. So if power goes out, they will actually be destaged, right? You will lose data. So for durability, we actually have to move the data to permanent storage, in this case, block device like SSDs or spinning media. Right?
Okay.
So I/O is actually quite important. There are two types of I/O we're talking about here. One is for logging, the other one is for checkpointing, and we can elaborate on those.
Okay, awesome.
Okay, so we already talked about the durability part. So all the committed transactions for durable tables are logged, and so it's actually counterintuitive to think about in-memory database can be bottlenecked on I/O. But if you think about the demo I showed you previously, if you get 10, 20x of transaction throughput, the log essentially is the size of data operation, right? You have to get all those data hardened somewhere. Well, that I/O has to happen now even at a higher scale than what you used to do. So I/O actually becomes even more a bottleneck potentially in memory. In-memory database situation. So this is the one consideration you really have to consider. So for log, the I/O by definition, you know, in default case is synchronous. So the transaction latency is actually gated by the I/O commit, right? So we actually recommend that you use a very good storage like SSDs for the log. For checkpointing, it's a little bit different. So checkpointing is an offline process. It does not block performance, so it's possible you can put that in a lower performing storage. It's very important to call out all in-memory OLTP IOs are sequential in nature. We don't do any random IO, and that's actually a very important factor to consider when you select the device. So checkpointing is not really needed for recovery. So log has the full fidelity of all the changes in the system. So if you keep all the log from the beginning of history until now, you're fine. But you don't want to replay the log for a long, long duration, right? So checkpointing is simply a way to snapshot the system, if you like, at certain times. So you only play the log, replay the log from that point on until the end, right? You want to recover too. So for checkpointing, for in-memory OLTP, we have two types of files. We have a data file, which captures the content of the roles. And we have a data file, which is essentially storing only the IDs of deleted roles. And the data file is defined or instantiated at 8 meg or 60 meg at a smaller system. And we write at large chunks at the time. We only append to it over time. Data files only stores in the ID of the deleted roles, and they also append it over time. So this is a quick example of what the files entail. And as you can see, that the data file has more payload, and the data file is essentially a particle antiparticle relationship, right? The particle is in data file, the antiparticle is in the data file. Logically, they cancel out each other. So this is I want to run you through this quickly, how we actually generate the checkpoint files. The checkpoint files are not generated from scanning memory. We actually don't scan the in-memory data structure to generate the checkpoint files, but instead, we scan the log, especially when the log is not hardened to disk, they're still in the log pool in memory. We scan that and generate the checkpoint files. So this is the offline process. It doesn't directly impact your performance, but if you indeed have to go back and scan the logs and pull them from the disk, then it could impact your performance. So keep in mind, that's something important to realize. So for example, on the top, you see this is the log sequence of all the operations in the log. And when we scan the log, we do this offline checkpoint thread, and we see there is a delete goes to the data for that range. And if it's another delete, goes to a different range. So it's really by range, right? By the timestamp range. And another delete example. And then we have an insert example. The insert goes to the data file for the corresponding range, OK? OK, so now I want to just show you quickly. I'm kind of running out of time. So I won't show you the script here. But what I can do is simply show you from the previous demo what the checkpoint files look like. So you may be familiar with this. This is the you may be familiar with this. This is simply a file stream files, right? And you can see in the folder, we pre-create, nine checkpoint files to start with. And then they will grow as time goes. And this is the world where I was showing the out-of-memory situation. So a lot of data actually got inserted. So you see those are roughly 128 meg files, the data files. And then you see the corresponding data files as well, so you can see those are the files. You don't have to do anything about it. There is no manual operation needed. The system will maintain this, which leads to the next topic of how we do merge.
Yeah, so those files are being created by default when you create tables and store procedure and all that. And you also mentioned that there is also sequential I/O only in in-memory OLTP. How does it take account the operations such as the updates and deletes?
Yeah, that's a very good question. If you think about it, if you harden the data to disk, and then the data will change over time, you will be having deletions and updates, right? Then logically, you have to go back to the middle of the file to modify the file. Then that's a random I/O.
Right.
So how do we get around it? So this is where the beauty of the two files come in, right? You have the data file, you keep appending new records, and you have a data file which keeps on telling the corresponding range which file should be deleted, right? So then you can think about, as I said, you know, the particles and antiparticles. Logically, they group together, give you the current view of the world. However, if you look at the files, it's almost like logically like a Swiss cheese full of holes, right?
Right.
So this is where the merge operation comes in, is that you scan a range of data and data files, and essentially, you know, get rid of all the holes and reclaim the space, right? So that's essentially what a merge does. And when you do merge operation, you simply read all the files in the corresponding range, and you generate a subset of smaller end result files.
Right.
And when you do this, you still do only sequential I/O, right?
Okay.
So the beauty of the whole design is you append only, you do occasional merge, and then you only do sequential I/O.
Okay.
Even though you have to do logical modification of the records. Right?
Makes sense. Okay.
Okay. So merge is a totally an online background operation. It does not impact the workload directly. So this is the offline process. Well, when I say online, it's in the system, doesn't block, but really it's a thread running, not in process. It's something else, and we will do the merge process. So let me show you what logically happens here. So this is on the left side. You see an example of the middle bar, two bars, right? The range 200 to 299 and 300 to 399. The delta is actually quite substantial, right? That means in the corresponding range, the valid data is actually not that much anymore. The utilization is less than 50% in the 200 to 300 range, right? So in that case, you really want to reclaim the space. So what we do is we group those two ranges together, 200 to 400, and we know that area can be reclaimed and reconsolidated into a one single range, and then the end result is you actually use a lot more, use a lot less physical space, and the efficiency is much higher. Okay.
Okay.
And so then you can reclaim the original space for the files.
How about you're talking about the data files and the data files and delta files also, right? How about the log files portion? Is there anything new with in-memory OLTP as far as log files?
Right. So log file, there is no separate log file for in-memory OLTP. Log is already a sequential I/O for SQL today. We integrate with log manager the same way. So the hackathon or the in-memory OLTP log records simply interlace with SQL's log records in the same log stream, right? But the most important thing to consider here is that several things. One is the index operation is never logged. Usually one table in OLTP has many, many indexes. So one operation, like an insert, will generate multiple records because of indexes. So that overhead is gone. Also, in memory OLTP log at the logical level. It's not logging at a physical level because we don't have the page structure, right? And also, we don't log a transaction until the transaction is committed because we don't do undo. So we don't have undo operation. So there is additional efficiency related to that. As far as recovery model is concerned, all the three recovery models are fully supported. And early on, we talked about the performance. Log I/O performance is actually very important because it does dictate how long a latency the transaction will have to endure before the commit can go back to the user. And if you select the default, you have to take that overhead. However, we did have a new option called lazy commit that you can specify. If you specify lazy commit, then the transaction would commit back ASAP as soon as it writes to the log in memory. Right, so this is a logging in memory. So the log has not been hardened to the I/O yet, but that's not a blocking factor for lazy commit. And in that case, you do have a small window of potential data loss. Right, the window is not large because we do asynchronously flush the log buffer every, I believe it's 60K byte. So the window is small, but you do have potential loss. So this is something very important to consider. But if indeed your throughput or latency is gated by the log I/O, or especially very large log I/O latency, this is a very valid option. Another thing I want to put a plug in here is also lazy commit is available for SQL as well. We actually backported this new feature back to SQL, and you can actually define this for SQL transactions as well.
Awesome.
So just at a high level, you want to specify the data storage to be 2 to 3 times of the user data. The reason is you have additional overhead of the delta data and the merge. If the merge is fully efficient and either doesn't have any overhead, then the overhead, you know, is relatively small, but there will be inefficiencies and it will take some time to fully catch up. So you need to allocate a little bit more physical disk space to account for that. And we talk about performance. Log is very important. Really, you want to use SSDs in general or very high-end spinning media at least. Log capacity, still, you know, there is no magic here. The size of the log is still roughly the size of the data change, right? So that's some physics we can't get over, right? It's still that case. And performance, we talked about. Latency is important. You can use delay durability as an option. And the non-durable table, of course, you get rid of the whole I/O stack altogether.
Right. So you talk about memory in very detail. You talk about storage. As DBA now, I'm really thinking about how am I going to back it up, this database, how am I going to restore, as well as how this high availability will work in memory OLTP. Can you explain that?
Yes. So the backup actually is quite simple. It's fully integrated. There is no special backup command for in-memory OLTP. You backup SQL, you backup all in-memory OLTP objects automatically.
Okay.
HA is also pretty transparent. You set up HA, including readable secondary. They're fully supported with in-memory OLTP tables. So those are the benefits of fully integrated with SQL Server.
Okay, awesome.
Okay, I just have a very small amount of information to cover, and we're done. So I want to just talk about recovery really quick. So the recovery of in-memory database is not lazy. In other words, if you think about SQL's recovery, you replay until tail of the log, and essentially you can open up the database for operation, and then you load in the data into buffer pool lazily as on demand. However, for in-memory OLTP, we do have to load all the in-memory data into the system, right, before we can open up the database for operation. So this is a RTO impact you have to factor in. And usually this is gated by your storage speed. So the way we do recovery is we do have to load the checkpoint file and then replay the tail of the log, right? So the way we load the checkpoint file is the first we load the delta file as a filter map, and then we load streams through the data file through it, right? And only load the valid rows, right? Non-deleted rows. So it's a very parallel process. Essentially, we can do this on as many logical cores as you provide. So it's actually quite efficient. The CPU is usually able to keep it up without any problem. But usually people are gated on I/O. So the rule of thumb is most of the I/Os we work with is roughly 1 gigabyte per second at best. So you can do a quick rule of thumb. The database recovery will take, let's say, for a 40 gig database, you may take 40 seconds. So this is something not as instantaneous as SQL. So you have to consider that. I think that's my last slide.
Awesome. Thanks, Kevin. So you've seen a lot of the benefits of in-memory OLTP, and then we talk about how to manage memory and storage, as well as high availability, backup, recovery within in-memory OLTP as well. Hopefully this session will give you great understanding from DBA perspective. How do you manage in-memory OLTP? So with that, we're going to take a meal break. We come back about an hour time frame. We'll be back here on the top of the hour. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll be back shortly.
Thank you.